Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة يا على الفلاح يا على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
إن الحمد لله نحمده تعالى ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما مزيدا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أيها المسلمون عباد الله أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله فإن خير الزاد التقوى My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, 30 months of the history of this ummah are some of the most amazing 30 months that happened after the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us several things in his sunnah to inform us of things that would happen after his death alayhi salatu wasallam. He told us in the hadith of Safina, which came in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala, that the Khilafah after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would be for 30 years. And when you look into the Khilafah after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and you add it up, the time of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu and Umar and Uthman and Ali radiyallahu anhum, it comes up to just a bit less than 30 years. But as the scholars mention, if you add after that the 6 or 7 months of the Khilafah of Al-Hasan ibn Ali, it's exactly 30 years. Then he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, after those 30 years, there will be a monarchy, kings. And he told us, alayhi salatu wasalam, in the hadith of Abu Hurairah and Sunan Abi Dawud, that after every 100 years, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send to this ummah a man who will revive the ummah. Man yujaddid lahum amr dinihim. And the ijma, the consensus of the scholars, that the first mujaddid ever sent to this ummah was Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, rahimahullah and radiyallahu anhu. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was the khalifa of the Muslims for 30 months. Only 30 months. But when you look through his biography and the things that he did in those 30 months, many people couldn't do in 30 years, in 30 decades. Absolutely amazing. When you look into his biography, it's as if it's a fairy tale, something from out of this world, something that could never have happened. When you look into his seerah, the stories are amazing. It increases our iman, our certainty in the greatness of this religion. One man was traveling to Damascus one time and he saw something very strange. He looked and he saw a flock of goats that had 30 dogs protecting the flock. He said, never seen this before. He went to the shepherd and he asked him, why are there 30 dogs guarding this flock? One or two dogs is enough. He said, I've never seen this in my life. Why so many dogs? The shepherd said to him, these are not dogs. They are wolves. Allahu Akbar. Even stranger. Wolves out grazing with the sheep. He said, ever since Ibn Abdul Aziz has become the Khalifa, the wolves have never attacked our sheep. And another story, a Bedouin lady living outside of the city in the desert areas outside, she said that, subhanAllah, she said to the people, before it was known that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz had passed away, rahimahullah, she said, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz has died. They said, how do you know? He said, because yesterday a wolf ate one of my sheep. And ever since he became the Khalifa, no wolf ever ate the sheep. SubhanAllah, the impact of his Khilafah, even the animals were safe. When you look into his upbringing, rahimahullah ta'ala, Umar ibn Khattab, one night as he was out patrolling in Medina, and he became tired, he leaned against the house and overheard a conversation of a woman and her daughter. They were a poor family, and the mother wanted to take the milk that they were selling and add some water to it in order to make more money. And the daughter, who feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and had strong iman, she said, did you not hear what Amir al-Mu'mineen, Umar ibn Khattab, said to the people? She said, what did he say? He said, don't mix. He forbid us from mixing the water and the milk. And don't cheat the people. It's haram. And she said to her daughter, where is Umar now? Umar can't see us. She said, what about Allah? Allah can see us. Umar, upon hearing this, he marked the door and told his servant Aslam to come back the next day and see if these women are married. When he found out they weren't married, he told his sons, I want you to marry this girl. And his son Asim radiallahu anhu married this lady who blessed him with a daughter by the name of Layla. Layla was the mother of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. This is how the story started. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was born into the royal family of that time. He had all the treasures and the pleasures of this dunya. But his father, even though he was the governor of Egypt, even though he had money, and he was from this royal family, he knew what was better. He knew what was important for his son. Not like today, where the people focus on the education and the deen, if it comes along with it, okay. But the important thing is he's educated. The important thing is he's successful in the dunya affairs. At a young age, he sent his son to Medina. He sent his son Umar ibn Abdulaziz to Medina to study from the scholars in Medina and to learn from their adab and their manners. And they focused on taking one of the fuqaha, one of the pious fuqaha and scholars of Medina, Salih ibn Kaysan, to be in charge of the tarbiyah of Umar ibn Abdulaziz. And they focused on ilm, making sure he had strong knowledge of the deen. And they focused on his worship, making sure that he was strong spiritually, mentally with the knowledge, and spiritually through his ibadah. And then focusing on his tarbiyah, his physical tarbiyah, that he was physically strong. One day, Salim Kisan, who used to make sure that he never missed any of the salawat. To be a true believer means to be in the masjid 5 times a day. One day, Umar ibn Abdulaziz didn't make it to the jama'ah. He didn't come to the salat. He was late. So Salim Kisan asked him, "Why were you late? Why didn't you come to the masjid?" He said, "Because my servant was busy with my hair. She was taking care of his hair. And that's why I was delayed." So what did he do? He sent a letter to his father, Abdulaziz, and told him what happened. His father immediately sent right away a person to shave his hair, to teach him we don't play around with the salat. The salat is the most important thing. And what was the outcomes of this tarbiyah, of this upbringing? Umar ibn Abdulaziz, one time his father Abdulaziz was coming for Hajj, and he came to Medina. He asked Salih ibn Kaysan, the Imam, "How is my son doing?" And he said to him, "By Allah," he said, "I've never seen anybody." And I want you to pay attention. Now, he's a young man at this time, not when he became older and he was very young at this time. He said, "I've never seen anybody Allah a'zam fi qalbihi min hadha al-fatah." He said, "I've never seen anybody who has more love or has the greatness of Allah in his heart than that young man." The greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala filled his heart because of this upbringing. The great sahabi, Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, the servant of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, "Ma ra'aytu ahadan ashbah bi salati Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in hadha al-fata." He said, I've never seen anybody whose prayer is closer to the prayer of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam than that young boy, Umar ibn Abdulaziz. Umar ibn Abdulaziz, when he became the Khalifa, he sent a clear message right away. First of all, he refused from day one to live in the palace, the presidential palace, where all the pleasures of the dunya were, and he chose a small mud house in the neighborhood of the Muslims to be with the general population, to see the needs of the Muslims. And he went home that night and he told his wife. And who was his wife? Fatima, the daughter of the Khalifa and the sister of two Khalifas. The sister of even more of the Khalifas who were from the sons of Abdul Malik. Her father was the Khalifa and her brothers were the Khulafa before Umar ibn Abdulaziz and two of them after Umar ibn Abdulaziz. Four of her brothers were from the Khulafa. She was raised in a house of money and treasures of the dunya. He said, "You see all this gold and these jewels that you have." He said, "You have one option. You return them to the Bayt Mal al-Muslimin. You return it to the Muslim property. And you live with me in this mud house, or I have to separate myself from you. You make the choice." She said, "I wouldn't choose anything in this dunya other than you." Because she had the same iman. She was following the footsteps of her husband. Umar ibn Abdulaziz, when you look at how he took care of his ummah, every single person under his command meant something to him. You didn't have to be from the important people. Oh, the VIPs, bismillah. And the other guys, in this masakin, let's put them in the back. One time during the Eid, and this used to be the custom back in the day before him, the Khulafa, the VIPs would be in the front, reserve section. And then the ones who were a little bit less in the back, and the ones in the back. Umar, he came, radiallahu anhu, to give the khutbah. He saw the empty spaces. He told the masakin to come. We're all one now. Because this is Islam. This is the teaching of Islam. It doesn't matter how rich you are. All of us are one. We're all brothers. All of us are equal. Who's better than the other? With the taqwa, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it clear in the Quran. One time Umar, a lady came to visit him from Iraq. This lady had 5 handicapped daughters. And she was poor and she couldn't take care of them. She needed to be with him all the time. She couldn't go out to work. She came to visit Umar ibn Abdul Aziz when she came from Iraq to Damascus. She said, "Where is the house of the Khilafah?" And she found this old mud house. She comes in and she sees the wife of the Khalifa fixing some things in her house with her own hands. And then a man comes and takes permission to come in the house. He comes in and he takes a pail of water, puts it on some clay and starts with the mud to fix some holes in the wall in the house. This lady from Iraq, thinking this is a servant, and he keeps looking over at them, she says to Fatima, the wife of the Khalifa, "Aren't you ashamed? You're not covering in front of this man?" She said, "He's not a servant, he's Amir al-Mu'mineen." Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, rahimahullah ta'ala. He sat down with the lady, hearing her story, he broke down into tears. That she had 5 handicapped daughters and nobody to take care of her. He wrote to the governor in Iraq for each one of the girls by their names that they would have a monthly salary from the Muslim state. When she reached Iraq, she gave the letter to the governor and he broke down into tears and said, "May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon Umar." And she was shocked. She said, "He died?" She said, "Yes, he died." Then she was scared. She screamed out loud because she thought now she's not going to get any money. And he said, "Don't worry, there's no harm that will come to you. I will honor what he wrote in this letter." A lady from Egypt who was a slave, a former slave, she sent to him a letter complaining that something happened to the wall of her house. And now it was short. It had fallen down and her chickens were being stolen. Look at this, the Khalifa, he's the leader of the Muslim. Imagine nowadays, even the Imam of the Masjid, somebody who has any authority, something small. If somebody told us that their wall fell down and their chickens are being stolen, we'd be like, "May Allah make it easy for him. Next letter." But Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, rahimahullah, he was on another level. This concerned him. This is one of the ra'iyah. This is one of the people he's in charge in. One of the people he's going to be asked about Yawm al-Qiyamah. He immediately replied to her and sent another letter to the governor, one of the ministers in Egypt, to fix her wall for her so her chickens wouldn't be stolen. That's how much he cared about his ummah, rahimahullah ta'ala. When you look into the seerah, the life of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, 2 things stick out to us. The issue of adl, how he was just and established justice, and how he was trustworthy, the amana that he had, rahimahullah ta'ala. One night, one of his ministers came over to talk to him about the affairs of the Muslims. And Umar was asking, "What's the situation of the Muslims in this area? What is the situation of this and that? And what about the non-Muslims as well?" All throughout his biography, you'll see that he also focused on taking care and making sure that the non-Muslims who were living under his command, that they were safe and good condition. After he finished talking about the issues of the government, the minister started to ask him about his personal situation, about his personal affairs. Umar radiallahu anhu then got up and he turned off the lantern that they were using. And he took another lantern and turned it on. The minister asked him, "Why? Why'd you turn off this one and turn on that one?" He said, "This one belongs to me and this one belongs to the Muslim state. So when I do the affairs of the Muslim state, I use this. But when this, my personal affairs, I'm going to use this lantern here so Allah doesn't ask me about wasting the money." Ya salam. Where could you find that in this world today? This type of honesty, this type of trust when it comes to the money of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he had under his command. Dealing even with the non-Muslims. One of the events that took time during the Khilafah of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was the conquering of the city of Samarkand, which is in Uzbekistan, under the command of Qutayba ibn Muslim. The city was conquered. The khair, the good was spread throughout the city. The tawheed, people started to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before they were worshiping idols, statues. As this was happening, the former leaders, religious leaders and political leaders of Samarkand, they became nervous. They're about to lose their power. They're about to lose everything. So they took one of their youth, who was very clever, and they sent him with a letter to Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. As he's traveling and going through the Muslim lands, he's seeing the difference between Islam and between what they worship. As he reached Damascus, he found a big place, people coming in and out. He assumed this was the place of the Khalifa. So he asked, what is this? He said, it's a masjid. One of the Muslims started to speak to him about Islam and ask him what he worshipped, and he found he worshipped statues. He started to speak to him, what can these statues do for you? Focus, look at this. Giving him da'wah through the issue of the fitrah, the natural inclination. And this is how we need to focus even on our da'wah. Da'wah to non-Muslims, da'wah to Muslims, is moving that natural inclination, that fitrah that everybody has inside. And once he realized that these statues can't benefit, they can't harm, they can't help him when he becomes sick, they can't feed him, and he saw the beauty of Islam, he accepted Islam. He went to Umar ibn Abdul Aziz and he told him what had happened, that Qutaybah ibn Muslim had entered the city and didn't warn them. Because the sunnah is to first call them to Islam, to give them da'wah, and then to give them the option of the jizya. And if they don't take that, then it's a battle after that. They have three options. Qutaybah didn't give them these options. He just entered into the city. Upon hearing this, Umar, he was very disturbed, and he sent a letter to Qutaybah ibn Muslim. And he sent a letter to the head of the judges during that time, who was Jami' ibn Hadir al-Baji. Jami' ibn Hadir al-Baji, who was the head of the qudat, of the judges in Samarqand. The day came for the court. Imagine this. They've conquered the city. And all of the worship that was done to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been nullified. Tawheed has been spread. Justice has been established in the city. People are happy. But the way it was done, was it correct or not? So they sat down, and as the judge came in, a man came in with old clothes, a skinny old man, and the people were shocked. This is the judge of the Muslims? This is how he looks? He comes and he sits down, and he hears the case from both sides. When he asked Qutaybah, is this true what they say, that you didn't warn them? That you just came in like this? He said, yes. Because of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-harbu khuda', that war is deception. And he said, but we are the followers of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who used to call the people to la ilaha illallah first, and then offer them the jizya, and then it would come to war. So he ordered them with the order of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, that if this were to be the correct story, that he didn't warn them, that the Muslims must leave the city. That the Muslims must leave the city. It's been conquered. Everything is good in the city now. People are happy, but no, you have to leave. And then you have to invite them to Islam and go through the steps again. Upon seeing this, the non-Muslims said, let's see what Qutaybah does. Is he going to answer to the command of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, or he's going to refuse? He obeyed the Khalifa. Upon seeing this, alhamdulillah, all of them who didn't enter into Islam, then entered into Islam. بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن والسنة ونفعاً وإياكم بما فيهما من الآية والحكمة أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. بسم الله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على النبي المصطفى وبعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, as we reflect on the life of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, rahimahullah ta'ala, one of the things that really stands out to us is his implementation of Islam according to the Quran and to the Sunnah of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the way of the Khulafa al-Rashideen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders us in the Quran, Inna Allah ya'murukum and to add the amanat ila ahliha. That Allah commands you to render trust to whom they are due. When وَإِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ أَن تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ. And if you were to judge between the people, that you judge justly and fairly. And this was the way of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. Whether he was dealing with Muslims or non-Muslims, whether he was dealing with those who went astray from the correct methodology and understanding of Islam, he was just in how he dealt with them. And subhanAllah, as we all look at these hideous attacks, or this hideous attack that happened in London the other day, we ask ourselves a lot of questions. People ask, what is the response? What is our stance? What should we say? We say, alhamdulillah, there doesn't always have to be a response from the Muslims. I think now that the majority of non-Muslims have understood that these maniacs, who do these types of things in the name of Islam, that they do not represent Islam or the Muslims. And if anybody had any knowledge, understanding of Islam, we would know what it means to kill an innocent person. We would know, if we had knowledge of Islam, as they say, the ends justify the means. This is the deen of Machiavelli, not the deen of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's Machiavelli who said the ends justify the means. You never hear this from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We take our religion from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We take our religion from the Quran and from the Sahaba and the way of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Anybody who has any type of knowledge of Islam, no, this is not permissible. Even non-Muslims, now they understand that alhamdulillah, this does not represent Islam. So we don't always have to be on the defensive side. Of course it's not us. Of course it doesn't represent us. How many Muslims are in the UK, and how rarely does this happen? Well, alhamdulillah. Every now and then, a maniac like that comes out. So what should our stance be? This should bring us closer together as a community, Muslim and non-Muslim, to stand against all forms of extremism, whether this extremism comes from Muslims or non-Muslims. Because the goal in the end is all of us want to live in peace. All of us want to live in harmony. All of us want to have a safe and upbringing for our children. Alhamdulillah, we're in a blessing. We're able to practice our religion here in the UK better than most Muslim countries. This is a reality. The UK is more Islamic for us than most Muslim countries. Look at it. Look at the Muslim countries around the world. Can you do the things you do in the UK? Look here in Birmingham. The amount of hijabs you see. The amount of practicing brothers you see. Wallah, you don't see it in a Muslim country. This is a ni'mah. It's a blessing that we have. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you a blessing, you have to close guard it. Alhamdulillah, we're in blessing. But like we said, also we need to increase our relationship with the local community. Instead of letting these type of things divide us, let it bring us closer together. And let us stand in solidarity against that which is wrong. Because who really gets harmed? This is important, ya ikhwan. Who really gets harmed by these type of events? Is it the non-Muslim? The non-Muslims are the ones getting affected by this? We're more affected by this as Muslims. This is an attack more against Islam and the Muslims than it is against them. How many innocent Muslims could have been there as well? Those children from France could have been all Muslims. Who knows? It could have been a Muslim brother walking with his children and his wife on that bridge. They could have been killed as well. And the backlash comes to who? To the Muslims. The backlash comes to us. Therefore, we're the ones being harmed more. And that should encourage us even more to work together in solidarity with the non-Muslim community. And take this as an opportunity to teach them what is true Islam. Alhamdulillah, like we said, it is changing. You still have the ones who are going to take this and they're going to attack Islam and the Muslims into the teaching of Islam. But alhamdulillah, they're a very small amount. And the haters are going to be haters. They're going to continue to hate. But it's upon us, alhamdulillah, to spread the rahmah and the mercy as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions used to do. ثم اعلموا رحم الله وإياكم أن الله قد أمركم بأمر بدأ بي بنفسه ثم ثنى بملائكة الكرام فقال عز وجل إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما ويقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من صلى علي بواحدة صلى الله عليها بعشرة اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وأنعم على نبينا محمد وارض اللهم عن الخلفاء الراشدين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وسائر الصحابة أجمعين اللهم عز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم عز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم عز الإسلام والمسلمين وذل الشرك والمشركين ودمر اللهم أعداك أعداء الدين اللهم آتنا نفوسنا تقواها وزكيها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها ربنا إننا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات ربنا حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان واجعلنا من الراشدين اللهم إنا نسألك أن تكون عونا ومعينا لإخواننا المستضعفين في كل مكان ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وقيموا الصلاة يرحمكم الله.
As the brothers and sisters are getting ready, inshallah ta'ala, a quick announcement. Alhamdulillah, we're going to continue reflecting on the story of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, rahimahullah. Obviously, in the khutbah, there was a lot we wanted to say, but we didn't have enough time. Alhamdulillah, we have a lecture tonight, inshallah, at 8:15, inshallah, continuing talking about his biography in a course tomorrow for 5 hours. So that shows you how deep the life of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz is. Inshallah, hope we can cover it in that small amount of time, inshallah ta'ala. So hopefully all of you will come out with the family, inshallah, to benefit from the lessons of the life of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, rahimahullah ta'ala.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Hayya ala salat, hayya ala al-falah. Qad qamat as-salatu, qad qamat as-salah. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah.
Stow, i'tadilu, stow, yirhamukum Allah. Everybody, please ensure your mobile phones are on silent. Jazakumullah khair. Allahu Akbar. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Maliki Yawmiddin. إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا نودي للصلاة من يوم الجمعة فاسعوا إلى ذكر الله وذروا البيع ذلكم خير لكم إن كنتم تعلمون فإذا قضيت الصلاة فانتشروا في الأرض وابتغوا من فضل الله واذكروا الله كثيرا لعلكم تفلحون وإذا رأوا تجارة أو لهوا انفضوا إليها وتركوك قائما قل ما عند الله خير من اللهو ومن التجارة والله خير الرازقين. الله أكبر.
سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر.
الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تلهكم أموالكم ولا أولادكم عن ذكر الله ومن يفعل ذلك فأولئك هم الخاسرون وأنفقوا مما رزقناكم من قبل أن يأتي أحدكم الموت فيقول
فيقول ربي لولا أخرتني إلى أجل قريب فأصدق وأكن من الصالحين ولن يؤخر الله نفسا إذا جاء أجلها والله خبير بما تعملون. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمدا. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
استغفر الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. A very important announcement. We will perform the Salat al-Janazah, inshallah, after the Sunnah, for the father of our Mu'adhin, Brother Muhammad Akbar and Brother Muhammad Asghar. And so we urge you all, brothers and sisters, to stay behind and take part, inshallah. Also, tonight's lecture after Isha is entitled The Creed of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, and will be delivered by Shaykh Abdur-Raheem McCarthy, inshallah. And the Shaykh Abdur-Raheem will also be delivering a seminar tomorrow, as he mentioned earlier, entitled The Life and Times of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz rahimahullah. The seminar will start at 5:30 p.m. inshallah. Please make sure to attend and also spread the word. As part of the GLM structured learning program, we now have two new courses available for brothers and sisters: the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the fiqh of Ramadan and Zakah. If you would like to sign up for these courses, please visit the masjid office or email dawah@greenlanemasjid.org. Islamwise monthly gathering for revert sisters will take place this Sunday at 1 p.m. inshallah. The theme for the gathering is Ramadan preparation begins now. The meetup for Revert Brothers will not take place this week due to the evening program in the masjid. Our food bank service urgently requires food donations. Please leave your donations during the office hours at the masjid reception through door C. East Africa is facing a catastrophe. The extent of suffering that is currently taking place means that millions are facing imminent death. Somalia, Sudan, Kenya, and Ethiopia are experiencing the worst humanitarian disaster of recent times. Brutal conflict and drought has led to famine, food scarcity, and extreme levels of poverty. This has left 800,000 children suffering from severe malnutrition. 16 million in East Africa are on the brink of death, and 23 million are in urgent need of food, water, and medical treatment. For more information regarding the campaign and what you can do about it, please visit the reception. And we have a short statement from the police and crime commissioner with regards to the recent attacks. And he says, what happened in Westminster was a senseless attack on our shared freedom and democracy. The terrorist responsible was exactly that, a terrorist, not a man of faith. Our thoughts are with those injured in the attack and the loved ones of those who tragically lost their lives, including fallen police officer Keith Palmer. P.C. Palmer died in the line of duty, protecting us and the values we hold dear. If there is any hope to be taken from this awful event, it is in the response of our brave emergency service workers who ran towards danger when all around them were fleeing, and in unity of our communities in the aftermath. There will always be threats to our way of life, and of course, we should all be vigilant at this time. However, we will not be cowed, we will not be beaten, and we will go on with our normal lives. Birmingham and West Midlands are places where people of all faiths, races, and religions live together side by side in a community where our children can flourish in peace and harmony. This will never change. And in light of these attacks in Westminster, we urge the community to report all hate crime to the police, irrespective of how minor it might be. Finally, please donate generously on your way out. Wa jazakumullahu khair.
inshallah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Dear brothers and sisters, if you can please take a seat for a couple of minutes. There's a few announcements that we need to make. It's not going to be too long. It's very quickly a point of reflection for us all. As you have heard the announcement, the deceased of today's janaza is the father of our muadhin, Brother Muhammad Akbar and Muhammad Asghar. I just want to focus on one point based on the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in which he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا مَاتَ الْإِنسَانِ إِنْقَطَعَ عَنْهُ عَمَلُهُ. When a man dies, son of Adam dies, his deeds are cut off, except of three deeds, that he continues receiving the rewards of those three deeds. And one of them is وَلَدٌ صَالِحٌ يَدْعُو لَهُ. Righteous children that he has left behind who can make dua for him. So this is a point of reflection for us all, that we need to reflect upon ourselves whether we have given the tarbiyah to our children in a way that when we leave this dunya, they are able to make dua for us. If you have done so, then thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this blessing. And if you haven't done, then you must reflect on this and think on the and focus on the tarbiyah of your children. As you can see, the father of our muadhin, Brother Muhammad Akbar and Brother Muhammad Asghar, alhamdulillah, we can have the hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that these are the pious children that this father has left behind, and inshallah al-Aziz, they will continue praying for their father, inshallah al-Aziz. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive his sins. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase his ranks in paradise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alleviate his place in Jannatul Firdaus al-A'la. Muhtaram Hazrat, jis tarah ke aap jante hain ke hamare aaj ke jo mayyit hain jinka namaz e janaza hum ada karne ja rahe hain, ye hamare muhtaram bhai Muhammad Akbar aur Muhammad Asghar unke walde girami the. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam ki ek hadith jo hame is mauke pe yaad aati hai, wo ye ke insaan jab is duniya se chala jata hai to uske tamam aamal, uski nekiyan is duniya se kat jati hain. Teen qism ki nekiyan hain jo uske marne ke baad bhi usko kaam aati hain aur usko uska sawab milta rehta hai. Unme se ek neki ye hai ke insaan apne piche apni nek aulad chhod ke jaye jo uske liye dua kar sake. Hum jab kabhi kisi ka janaza ada kare aur khaas taur pe kisi buzurg ka, to hame اس حدیث کو ذہن میں رکھنا چاہیے اور اپنی زندگی کا جائزہ لینا چاہیے کہ کیا ہم نے اپنی اولاد کی اس انداز سے تربیت کی ہے یا نہیں کہ وہ ہمارے مرنے کے بعد ہمارے لیے دعا کر سکیں اور ان کی نیکیوں کا ہمیں فائدہ پہنچ سکیں. اگر تو ایسا کیا ہے تو اللہ کا شکر ادا کرنا چاہیے, اگر نہیں تو ہمیں اپنی اصلاح کرنی چاہیے اور اس سے اپنے لیے سبق حاصل کرنا چاہیے. اللہ رب العالمین ہمارے اس فوت شدہ کی مغفرت فرمائے, ان کی غلطیوں اور گناہوں کو معاف فرمائے, ان کے درجات کو اللہ رب العالمین بلند فرمائے. And inshallah, now we are going to pray Salatul Janaza. Can I request all the brothers and sisters to line up? And on the family, on the request of the family, we are going to pray Salatul Janaza out loud, as it is reported from some of the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it was practiced by Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma on some occasions. So on the request of the family, we are going to pray Salatul Janaza out loud. The prophetic method of performing Salatul Janaza is that it contains four takbirat. After the first takbir, we recite Suratul Fatiha, an additional surah from the Quran. And after the second takbir, we read Salah upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we read in our Salah in Tashahud, Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala Ali Muhammad. And after the third takbir, we make dua for the deceased. And after the fourth takbir, we conclude Salatul Janaza with Taslim. Allahu Akbar. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawmiddin, Iyaka Na'budu wa Iyaka Nasta'een, Ihdina الصراط المستقيم, صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم, غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. الله أكبر. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. الله أكبر. اللهم اغفر لحينا وميتنا وشاهدنا وغائبنا وصغيرنا وكبيرنا وذكرنا وأنثانا. اللهم من أحييته منا فأحيه على الإسلام ومن توفيته منا فتوفه على الإيمان. اللهم لا تحرمنا أجره ولا تضلنا بعده. اللهم اغفر له وارحمه وعافه واعف عنه. اللهم أكرم نزله ووسع مدخله. اللهم اغسله بالماء والثلج والبرد ونقه من الخطايا كما نقيت الثوب الأبيض من الدنس. اللهم أبدله دارا خيرا من داره وأهلا خيرا من أهله وزوجا خيرا من زوجه. اللهم أدخله الجنة الفردوس. اللهم أدخله الجنة الفردوس. اللهم أدخله الجنة الفردوس. اللهم أعذه من فتنة القبر وعذاب النار. اللهم أعذه من فتنة القبر وعذاب النار. اللهم أعذه من فتنة القبر وعذاب النار. اللهم ثبته بالقول الثابت. اللهم ثبته بالقول الثابت. اللهم إنه إن كان محسنا فزد في حسناته وإن كان مسيئا فتجاوز عن سيئاته يا أرحم الراحمين. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. Inshallah, the burial will take place tomorrow at 11:30. At 11 o'clock, sorry, at 11 o'clock.